Welcome to September's Art and Soul Show here at Ipsum. We have the usual selection of music, poetry and chat. This month we have an interview with Chris Barry from the Wilts and Berks Canal Trust and an interview with our very own Scott Cowley, aka Rusty Goat, about the release of his new book entitled Not Under My Breath. And to start the show, we have Earth, Wind and Fire and September.
Next on the Art and Soul Show is a song that I've chosen by me, Eden, and that is Clean Bandit featuring Jess Glynn, Rather Be. This was a good year for me and brings back a lot of good memories.
Up the batteries. Rusty Goat, aka Scott Cowley.
Rusty Goat's back again.
Yes, he is indeed. And you've got a book out.
I have got a book out, yes. It was launched on the 19th of July.
We did launch in Barrister Cats. It was absolutely fantastic.
What a night that was, man. Such a great night. Great turnout. Wonderful atmosphere, as always.
Yeah, two really strong sets from you and Holly.
Yeah, along with my launch of my book titled Not Under My Breath. You've also got a poet from Worcester, Holly DeFern, releasing the book at the same time through the same publishers.
And so you did a double thing. You did Friday night in Swindon and then Saturday night in Worcester.
Yeah, back-to-back launches. Yeah, Friday night in Swindon at Bristol Cats and Saturday night at Paradiddles in Worcester.
Paradiddles.
Yeah, great bar as well.
Good
great
venue.
Excellent venue. Yeah,
that one went really well too.
Yeah, it was a fantastic. Couldn't have asked for a better weekend for...
Tell me more about the book. It's called Not Under My Breath.
It is titled Not Under My Breath, and this publishing house has been set up to specifically publish spoken word artists.
Yep.
So it's not your traditional page poetry.
Yep.
But the title Not Under My Breath comes from one of my signature pieces of poetry. It's a title for one of that.
And you've based the whole book around the themes of this particular poem, really.
The book is based around I guess the last three decades of my life. You know, we've got life crisis, love and discovery in there, you know, all the battles with mental health that have been over the years and substance misuse, alcohol misuse.
And so what do you hope the book achieves?
I hope the book will open the reader's eyes to a multitude of issues that someone else has suffered with and continues to suffer with. I'm hoping that then will then open their eyes to the fact that, you know, it's okay to talk about these things.
It's all about opening doors for conversations.
Opening doors for conversations into difficult subjects.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And how can we get hold of the book?
You can buy the book direct from the publishers at www.bitepress.co.uk.
So if you Google search Bite Poetry Press, that'll come up, right?
Yeah, Bite Poetry Press, that'll bring you up the website. Click on there. There's a couple of poetry publications available there. They do a lot of work with the community in Worcester as well. And they'll be. It's going to be an ongoing project.
Yeah, there's going to be more and more collaboration between them and Worcester and you here in Swindon.
Yeah, we're hoping that, that bond will become stronger and we can work together on projects.
And this is really a continuation of the work you've already been doing as part of Rusty Goat's Poetry Corner, which happens on the first Monday of every month at 7 p.m. in the excellent Barrister Cats on Commercial Road.
Yeah, much love to Marcus and Tracy Kitteridge for allowing us to use their space every month. Like you've said, it's the first Monday of every month. We opened up the doors there, you know, and people come in and make it their night. We actively encourage and support people talking about mental health and recovery from a multitude of things. You know, it's good to encourage people to come along and to share their stuff, and people come back every month with new stuff.
And one of the most important things about it is that Baristacats is a no alcohol venue.
Yeah, Baristacats doesn't have an alcohol license. They could apply for one for short term, but Rusty Goat's Poetry Corner, we have the ethos that, you know, we maintain and promote the fact that we are a dry night.
Well, thank you for coming in to speak to us today, Scott. How can we get hold of your book again?
You can get hold of my book at bitepress.co.uk, only available via the publishers, or if you bump into me, I've got copies on me and I'm quite happy to sign them for you.
Excellent. Thanks very much for coming in. Have a great day.
Now on the Art and Soul Show, a song from 2015, Courtney Barnett, Pedestrian at Best.
Welcome Chris Barry back again from the Wilts and Barks Canal Trust. Chris came and visited us about a year ago. A lot has been happening on the canal since, things have been developing. So we thought we'd get Chris back just to give us some updates. Thanks for coming along, Chris. Great to see you again.
My pleasure.
The new section. Everyone wants to hear about the new section up at H&W, the pub there by Waitrose. Can you tell us a bit about how that's developing and what the current situation is?
The short answer is very well, I think. Right. I mean, the pub, as everybody knows, opened, what was it, January this year? Needless to say, I've been a number of times, and I've met the manager there, who's extremely keen and supportive and wants to make the canal, which is already a feature there, but he wants to help and support us in any way he can.
Yes. I think it's a great place there, isn't it? I think it's they've built it well. It's well designed.
It's an amazing atmosphere. Yes, the whole place.
Yeah, and the bridge as well. Of course, is the footbridge is quite a feature there, isn't
it? I'm told that's opening any day now, but I have been told that before.
Yes. There are a number of things that are very imminent. In relation to the canal itself, I'm aware there's a dam a bit further back from the new section of canal. Now that's still in place, isn't it? There's a lot of talk about that and what's happening there.
I was there a few days ago. There are actually two dams. One has appeared more recently, and that's under the road bridge that's by Waitrose. And obviously the dam we all know about was put there so that they could dig out the canal and put massive drains under it and then put the canal back and try and make sure it was waterproof. And all that seemed okay, but it seemed as though the section up by Waitrose was losing a bit of water, was leaking a bit.
Right.
All canals tend to leak to some degree, but obviously you try and keep it to a minimum. So that at the moment is a question mark, but I have been told that certainly the main dam will be removed, I have been told, within the next week or two.
Okay. In terms of sort of modern canal building, clearly the canals originally were lined in clay, I think, is that right? Would they use the same process with a new section, or is it a sort of
absolutely the same, except that instead of thousands of navvies, the Irish labourers, the navigators that built the canals, instead of them puddling the clay, you just buy puddled clay from I don't know where, and it comes in lorries and on diggers, and it's
the same traditional method that they've used. It's not a sort of a liner or anything
same,
like that.
Same method, and the reason is because it's flexible. Between summer and winter, frost and so forth, the ground moves around a bit.
Yeah.
And some canals have been repaired or rebuilt using concrete, but there is rather a tendency for that to crack and cause problems.
Right. Because the water level, I did actually happen to notice the other day, the water level seemed a bit lower up at H&W there by the pub, but I suppose it's been very dry recently, hasn't it?
The problem is it hasn't rained.
Yes.
And when you rebuild a canal, you need rain to fill it because water won't come from anywhere else.
Yeah.
There aren't any friendly streams nearby. You need rain to fill it, and then you need a dry spell so that you can look at the water level, and if it's going down a bit, you know there's a leak, in which case you have to start finding it. And if it doesn't go down, then you're okay. So. Yeah. You know, I do appreciate that they've been a bit stuck for that with all the recent fine weather. What a shame.
Yes. So I suppose you guys are really looking forward to the dam coming out, because you'll be able to start raising more funds in terms of the canal boat itself.
Absolutely.
People actually going on trips up, on the full length of what's available.
Yes, I mean, financially it's been fairly disastrous for us, but I mean, that's not anybody's fault. So yes, we can't wait to get back to Waitrose and Hall and Woodhouse and take people on trips and perhaps even booze cruises. Who knows?
So do you have? I suppose do you have a date, sort of a sort of grand opening or a planned weekend when it is, or you'll announce that, I suppose, when it is actually finally open? Would you to
well because
it?
Nobody knows when it will be safe, as it were, to remove the dams and have all the bits of water joined up as one. We can't really have a date. There is an event planned for the 24th of August, which is a sort of mini Olympics centred around Wichelstow. And Holland, Woodhouse and Waitrose have been very central in the planning and organisation of this, and the Trust has been part of that.
So when you say, they can have different events on the canal, is that the plan?
Yes, canoeing mainly. We'll have the boat going up and down if the dam isn't there, possibly even more than one boat. And the little boats on the canal are also primed and ready to go, as it were.
Excellent. So did you mention a date there? Did you say August?
24th of August.
24th of August. So that's something to bear in mind, isn't it?
It's engraved on my forehead, yes.
Yeah. That'd be really good. And the footpath is open now. So the lovely new path runs all the way along.
Yes, it opened last week, and our team of volunteers strimmed it a few days after it was opened, so it's now in use. And again, I went down there, and I've posted a picture on our Facebook page.
Right. It's a great walk, isn't it, now? Because there's a bit of it's almost like nature reserve, really, isn't it, the way they've planned it?
It's a sort of green corridor, really, and canals everywhere are a bit like that.
Yeah, so it'll attract walkers, won't it? I think there's a lot to do. You can get the other end, have a drink.
Yes, and plenty of water-based wildlife. And I had my first sight there the other day of a terrapin in the canal.
Really?
Yes, I'd heard they were there.
Right.
And actually saw one, but by the time I got my camera out, it had jumped into the water.
We saw a grass snake actually swimming across the other
week. We did?
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
right.
Yes,
I've seen that about three times.
Have you? Yeah.
Never before in my life.
No. It attracts a lot of wildlife, doesn't it?
Oh, and, yes.
I heard a story about the swan, actually, the cygnet, the lost cygnet,
yes,
which they found and returned to mum and dad.
Yes, there was a big panic going, and it was all a bit of a sort of false alarm, really.
Right.
What happened was that somebody had seen a swan being bundled into a bag and taken away by two people. But what that was that apparently some kids in an inflatable had been pestering the swans a bit. So the RSPCA came, took the cygnet away, decided it was all right, and next day brought it back and returned it to its parents. So
good. Well, it got back.
A bit of a storm in a teacup or canal bucket, whatever you might like to call it.
Right. Something else I was going to just ask about, not actually in connection with the canal here in Swindon, the Peterborough Arms.
Lynham Banks.
That's
it's
right.
The road
that's
that goes down from Lynham towards the Junction 16 on the M4. Yeah.
Very, because that's all part of the Wiltshire Canal Trust, isn't it?
Or Canal Trust bought it and renovated it, brought it up to modern standards, and it's there's a couple there, Brendan and Michelle, who lease it from us and run a superb.
It's great. We actually went and had a meal there the other week. I was just going to mention it as something that's been a real success for the Canal Trust as well.
Yeah.
Something else.
Yeah. The hog roast is something to die for.
Yeah, that's great. Well, that sort of brings us up to date with things. So obviously a lot of things are quite imminent in the next sort of few weeks, really.
Yes,
so,
we very much hope
we'll be
so.
Watching with interest as things develop, and also for people to keep an eye out for things and pay a visit.
And the wildlife, water voles, everyone loves herons, swans are there. And the usual ducks and so forth, ducklings and baby ducklings, lots of those.
In terms of parking, to sort of gain access, I know the Running Horse are happy for people to park there, I think. I'm right.
They are indeed, yes. We've been in touch, we've spoken with them many times, and they're more than happy for people to park in their car park. And we've put signs from the back of their car park leading through, and it's the shortest way to get to the canal from the road, actually.
So that would be quite a good place to head for, really, wouldn't it?
Although it isn't wheelchair friendly, but this was pointed out to me by someone on Facebook who used a wheelchair, and you can get a wheelchair along the towpath from the Esso garage at the bottom of King's Hill.
Yeah, and of course Hall and Wood
might
House
even be
as
a
well.
Shell garage.
I think it is Esso actually. Yeah, it is.
Is it
but,
right?
Of course, Hall and Wood House have a park. I think they've got a large car park now as well, haven't they? There.
Oh yes.
So there's, that's an alternative place for people to.
Yes, the bank on that side is a bit higher than the bank on the Waitrose side, but of course with a footbridge there. I mean, once we're back at Waitrose, there's no problem at all because we have a ramp from the Waitrose car park. So either Waitrose or the Hall and Wood House, and a wheelchair can easily reach the boat.
That's great. That's great. That's lovely. Thanks for coming along, Chris. It's good to see you again.
My pleasure.
And I'm sure I'll bump into you at some point along the towpath.
Yep,
that'd
indeed.
Be great to see you.
Indeed.
Right. Thanks again. Cheers,
okay.
Chris.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
In honour of Chris Barry, the canal man, we now have a montage of waterway-related tunes. Josh McRae with Messing About on the River, Steve Hackett, Tales of the Riverbank, and the theme tune from Rosie and Jim. Enjoy.
When the weather is fine, then you know it's a sign for messing about on the river. If you take my advice, there's nothing so nice as messing about on the river. There are longboats and shortboats and all sorts of craft, and cruisers and keelboats and some with no draft. So take off your coat and hop in a boat, go messing about on the river. There are boats made from kits that reach you in bits for messing about on the river. Or you might like to scowl in a glass fiber hull, just messing about in the river. There are tillers and rudders and anchors and cleats and ropes that are sometimes referred to as sheets. With the wind in your face, there's no finer place than messing about in the river. There are skippers and mates and rowing club aides, just messing about in the river. There are pontons and trots and all sorts of knots, or messing about in the river. With inboards and outboards and dinghies you sail, the first thing you learn is the right way to bail. In a one-seat canoe, you're the skipper and crew, just messing about on the river. There are bridges and locks and moorings and docks when messing about on the river. There's a whirlpool and weir that you mustn't go near when messing about on the river. There are backwater places all hidden from view, and quaint little islands just awaiting for you. So I'll leave you right now to cast off your bow, to go messing about on the river.
Jim, we play our games.
Quack.
Rosie and Jim, finding stories every day. Rosie and Jim, and John, he writes them down.
Hello, I'm John. You saw me steering the boat just now, but that's not my real job. My real job is writing books. For children just like you. I'm writing a new book just now, all about Rosie and Jim. They're my two rag dolls that I have on the boat. I like to pretend that they come to life, and I get ideas for stories about them from the things I see as I travel along on my boat. What shall I put in my story today?
Ipsum care while you listen to this. Your ears can't look elsewhere.
And now Oz talks to Brian about dangerous animals.
You want to chat about some dangerous animals?
Yeah, I met most of these. In fact, I met all of these.
Yeah.
The biggest one, estuarine crocodile.
Were they good to hang out with or?
No, estuarine crocodiles eat you.
Okay.
And it's 4 meters long.
So long enough to eat you then?
Oh, very much so. Yeah. In fact, luckily for me, it was parked on the side of the riverbank having a rest. Now, these estuarines live in rivers or in the sea, so it was nice. We were walking down towards the beach, yeah, and that's where we met him.
Wow.
Horrible thing.
Just sort of like lurking there, hanging
yeah,
about.
Just lying there in the sun, you know. Of course, we were told that they could run faster than us.
Wow.
So I got too close with the camera.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, quite.
Yeah. Now, you also met some dangerous birds as well.
Oh, yes, the most dangerous bird in the world.
Yeah.
Cassowary.
Cassowary.
Yeah, it lives in North Australia and New Guinea.
Okay.
It's about the size of an emu, uh-huh, but it's the second heaviest bird in the world.
Okay.
And it does headbutts. So if you get too close to it, it headbutts you and it breaks your arms or your legs.
You see, I don't trust swans, so no. This sounds even worse.
Oh, this is a lot worse. But the great thing is it's got 5-inch long central claw in each foot.
Ooh.
And they just rip you open. In fact, they quite easily kill you. It's not a problem. So you do not go near cassowaries, even though they look beautiful.
Well, I don't know what they look like, but I know that I'll try and avoid them. So you also met a hyena.
Yeah, that was silly. I got up late one night to go to the toilet in the camp and wandered across to the toilet. And there was this hyena wandering around, just sort of scavenging.
Yeah.
And when they're on their own, they're not too bad. I don't think they're particularly dangerous. But when you get a whole group of them, that is dangerous. And I sort of...
Kind of like humans.
Yeah, I just froze and didn't do anything, waited for it to go away.
And snakes too?
Oh, snakes. My first experience with a dangerous snake was in New Guinea, a Papuan black. And I was sitting watching a basketball match, and suddenly everybody stopped and looked at me. And I thought, what's that? What's going on? And I looked down, and there was this Papuan black snake heading straight for me. And it went up my leg, along my thigh, onto the bench, and away. And I thought, you can't move. You must not move.
Boy.
Oh, dear. That was one of the most frightening moments, having a Papuan black come
along. That is a hold your breath moment, that, isn't it?
Very much. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But the boomslang, the other one that I had problems with, I didn't realise. I was looking at the ducting going into the radio station, and I could see this thing sticking out. So I got hold of it and pulled. Turned out to be a boomslang snake.
Oh, no.
And I thought, it's only a green mamba. They're not bad. They're not aggressive. So I pulled it out, got the camera, started taking photos. Went into the radio station, internet, boom slang, deadly, absolutely appalling.
Yeah.
You're dead, basically, if one of those gets you. And so
I'm feeling uncomfortable just
that was the last time I ever got involved with snakes. I just stayed well away from then on.
Oh, yeah. I think that's probably wise in general.
Yeah.
As a rule in life.
Being stupid, I just did silly things.
Creatures that are a little bit closer to home most of the time. Bats.
Oh, bats. Oh, rabies with bats.
Oh, yeah.
But this, I got sent to this tent because I was out in Sudan in the middle of nowhere, no hotels.
Yeah.
And they said, you have to sleep in that tent. Well, I got there and the door was open. You know, the zipped thing was open.
Uh-huh.
And I said, well, why is that open? Oh, well, there's a bat living in there and you have to leave it open for it to come in and out. So I went in and there's this bat hanging off the central pole. And it stank.
Wow.
And so in the night it disappeared, and in the morning it came back, and it then defecated. And it made it even more of a smell.
Yeah.
I thought, that's it, I'm not staying here.
No.
And then I went back to the radio station, put a bed up in there, and I was living in the radio station.
Yeah. And, you know, we're getting smaller and smaller as we go through these.
Oh, yes.
We're getting to some flies now.
Yeah, these are weird. They lay these eggs on the ground. Or they lay it on your washing as it's drying on the bushes.
All right.
And of course, the local people know that you must iron your clothing to kill off these bugs.
Okay.
But if you don't, they burrow into your skin and cause problems. Well, on the road, when you're walking along through the bush, they get into your toes. And I had one burrow into my big toe.
Oh, no.
And I came home and I was sitting watching telly and girlfriend says, there's something, your toe is weeping, there's something wrong. So I said, well, have a look. So she had a look and she said, there's something living in there. So we got a razor and cut it out, and it was a bug.
Wow.
It was quite happy living in there. Yeah, not nice.
And going right down to the smallest thing on my list right now, mosquitoes.
Oh, mosquitoes, they are the biggest killer of humans in the world. They kill.
Whilst also being the smallest.
Well, they are the smallest as well.
Yeah.
Not the biggest. Oh, right. You know, you would, wouldn't you? No, they're the smallest, yes. All right. But they kill more people than any other creature.
Yeah.
2 million people every year.
Yeah.
Black Death only killed 60,000 over 8 years.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And the mosquitoes. And there's dengue fever as well that they push around.
Yeah.
And so you've got more chance of dying, being bitten by a mosquito than anything else. And wow. I've had malaria three times, different types. Yeah. And I've never had the dangerous one. So wow. I've only had the mild versions.
Yeah.
So yeah, I've met some really interesting creatures, ones that I don't think I want to meet again.
Have you ever come across any bipolar bears?
No, I've heard about bipolar bears. I've heard that you know a lot about bipolar bears.
Yeah, I've been conducting a study on the life of bears living with bipolar. I'm actually putting a book out about it on the 6th of August.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
That, does that mean I'll be able to understand it? Because you're a bit of an intellectual.
Oh, no, I've made sure that it's not a textbook.
All right, so even I can understand it.
There's so many textbooks about bipolar and stuff like that. I wanted it to make sure it wasn't one of those.
So it's on the market now, Oz, and I would like to know how much it would cost me and where would I get it?
10 golden nuggets.
10 golden nuggets. And?
£10. And you can get it from Amazon or you can walk into your local bookstore and ask them to order it for you.
Brilliant. That's great. Well, thank you. That's really good information.
Yeah, thank you for coming in. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Welcome to Ipsum's Art and Soul Show, where you'll get the best of everything Swindon has to offer in the line of arts and music. Also, interviews with the top professionals helping get your life back on track. So join us the first Tuesday and Wednesday every month. See you there.
And now Sue Hammond with a poem called No Designer Disability.
No Designer Disability. I woke up this morning because I had to. I couldn't stop myself. The radio droned. I gradually dropped back into the twilight zone, the haven for people like me who don't want today to come. The dog nudged me. The cat walked across me. Daylight overwhelmed me and I led there, mulling over excuses. I led there because I could, and I led there because I couldn't. I couldn't muster the energy I had to tell myself I would feel so much better. I got out of bed today because I had to. I did all the stuff that is expected of me because it is expected. I took the pills that I've been prescribed because they've been prescribed. I washed because I had to go out. I put on a dress because it was an easy choice. Easy to put on, easy to launder, easier than two pieces, easier thinking, less energy in doing. I put on the shoes because they were already there. I used the comb that lay there to pull through my hair because to look kempt means fewer questions. I drove without concentrating. I got there without engaging. I did the things I needed to because I needed to. I walked the dog because it's good for her and because it's good for me. But I lacked the energy. I lacked the drive. I practice gratitude because I can and because I am. Grateful, that is, for all the good things I have and for all the things I see and my comparative riches. But you see, this is no whinge. This isn't an epistle of ingratitude or an ode to moaning on. This is no designer disability that will be out of fashion before the end of season. It's the face of invisibility. It's just the unseen reason. So today I got up because it's expected. And tomorrow I expect I will do the same.
So that was a poem by Sue Hammond called No Designer Disability, and now on the Art and Soul Show, Undiscovered by James Morrison.
You, you bite your tongue, you don't know why or where I'm coming from. But in my head, I'm close to you. We're in the rain, still searching for the sun. You think that I wanna run and hide? I keep it all locked up inside. I just want you to find me. I'm not lost, I'm not lost, just undiscovered. And when we're alone, we're all the same as each other. You see the
there's nothing wrong, nothing wrong. You think that I wanna run and hide, I keep it all locked up inside, but I just want you to find me.
And now, a track chosen by Katie called Bluebells by Light Garden.
To the sweet sound of bluebells ringing. could go down, I could go down.
Right, hello, this is Andrew, and this is Food Tips of the Month by me. I believe if you're hungry around the late afternoon, around 4 o'clock, you should always pop into Marks and Spencer's sandwich variety there. And what they do after four, around four or onwards, they reduce most of their sandwiches, and they are big fat ones, and they are delicious. That's what I recommend anybody should do if they're hungry and they want cheap sandwiches. Thank you.
Next on the Art Unsold show, a King's classic for this time of year from 1967, Autumn Almanac.
That was Autumn Almanac by the Kinks. And now, the joke of the month. Jethro's out on an early morning misty walk across the fields. In the distance he sees a figure walking towards him. I think that's Denzel. I can tell by that old stick he always carries. Denzel looks into the distance through the mist and he sees a figure. That's Jethro, he thinks. I can tell he's got his dog Patch with him. As they get closer, Jethro sees Denzel and thinks, yeah, that's him. He's got that old hat he always wears. Denzel thinks that is Jethro. He's whistling that tune he always whistles when he's walking. They meet and pass. It's neither of them.
That was September's Art and Soul Show. Thank you very much for listening. And to play us out this month, we have Green Day with When September Ends.
Summer has come and passed. The innocent can never last. Wake me up when September ends. Like my father's come to pass, 7 years has gone so fast. Wake me up when September ends. Here comes the rain again, falling from the stars, drenched in my pain again, becoming who we are. As my memory rests, but never forgets what I lost, wake me up when September ends. The innocent can never